el poeta de la salsa, Rubén Blades. Well, thank you very much for being here tonight.
It's a tough night to be out.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Just a warning, we both have a bit of a cold, so if it gets a bit...
Who doesn't?
Yeah, who doesn't? So, Ruben, let's get something straight. Mm. Is it Blades or is it Blades?
No. Look, the correct pronunciation of the name is Blades. Because my grandfather, and I've said this so many times, my family comes from all over the place, all over the world. My father's father is English, and that's where Blades comes from. And he comes from St. Lucie. So it's not just Blades, it's Blades. Blades. He comes from St. Lucie. Entonces, my grandmother is from on my father's side. She's from Colombia. She was born in Colombia when Panama was a department of Colombia. On my mother's side, my grandfather was born in Louisiana, but his last name is Bellido de Luna. And then my grandmother on my mother's side, she was born in Galicia, in Spain, Orense. So, you know, everybody comes from everywhere else. But in Latin America, for many years, I've been called Blades, and I took it as, I don't have a problem with that. It did become a problem at one point when people thought I was trying to Americanize my name. You know, it's like, oh, he's Blades, now he's Blades. You know, and it's like, no, it's Blades, and I never had a problem in Panama. Because in Panama, you have people who come from all over the place. You have Mauricio Smith. You have Rod Caru. No, you had so many people with last names that are from the Caribbean, English. So the right name is Blades. But people call me Blades, and I do not have a problem with that. Please do not feel bad. I myself say Blades many times. And sometimes I say Rubén Blades Blades, which confuses more. The issue.
Well, para los latinos, is Blades.
Yes.
Let's keep it like and that.
Y con mucho orgullo se acepta.
Gracias. Bien. So, Rubén, it's really hard to describe your career. It's 34 albums, 14 Grammys, 8 Grammys, 6 Latin Grammys, if I'm right. Currently, you have been an actor also, over 35 films and TV programs. Currently, you are on Fear of the Walking Dead.
Fear of the Walking Dead.
Yep. But obviously, everybody here and on Facebook Live are really dying to hear about your beginnings. And I want to start with a moment in your life, which was the first album you recorded. Yeah? Y se llama De Panamá a Nueva York.
I'm that guy over there with those weird sideburns.
Right, so...
I probably still have that shirt.
¿Y el carro?
No, ese carro, that car was... they rented that thing. I didn't like it.
But, you know. So, it's 1969.
Right.
Rubén is in Panama. How does Rubén get to New York?
You know, it's a long... the only trouble is you always have just an hour and short to say, you know, to explain things that are so complicated. I was at the time in Panama. I was studying law. I had been called my dean, the dean of the law school, Dulio Arroyo, called me. He found out there was another teacher, Derecho Civil, Civil Law. Narciso Garay saw me playing with Los Salvajes del Ritmo in a private party, and he went and he told the dean that he had seen one of his students in first year law playing with some people drums and cavorting instead of being at home studying. And I got called, immediately summoned to the dean's office. The dean sat me down and he point blank said, "You're gonna be a musician or you're gonna be a lawyer?" And I said, "A lawyer." And then he said to me, "You're gonna be a musician or you're gonna be a lawyer?" And I thought, a lawyer. And then he said, "Well, you gotta stop this nonsense of playing and singing around." So I quit. You know? So by the time that, and this is 1968, 69, beginning of 69. And we had also to take into consideration the fact that a friend of mine had a band, and in Panama there was the first time a recording studio had been created, first one. So they put everything in, and then, everything that makes a studio be a studio. But nobody knew the things that they had just done worked. So they needed a band. So the guy called me to go sing with the band. And I said, "I can't do that because they'll kill me. I will be, the dean of the law school will personally have me executed. I can't do this." So he said, "No, please, Ruben." And I said, "No, you know, the one thing I could do, maybe help you with the choruses." So I said, "Yeah, okay." Because I was curious also. I never heard myself in a recording. So I don't know how I'm going to sound. So I went over, and I also asked permission from the singer. Anel Castro was the singer, Bushy Los Magníficos. And I asked permission from Anel Castro if he would be okay if I was in the session. And he said, "Sure, Ruben, no problem." But what happened? A lot of everything that has happened to me, there's always an element of luck. The band was, I think there were three guys or two guys in the band, horns. I think it was trumpet and trombone and sax. The trombone guy got lost and didn't show up. So they couldn't play the charts. So then they started playing wataka, you know, improvisation, C7s. And Chombo Castro wasn't as good at doing that as I was. So at one point somebody said, "Why don't you sing something?" And I said, "I'm going to be in trouble." "No, come on, who's going to know?" So I did El Raton, the Joe Cuba. Joe Feliciano was my idol, is my idol. And I did El Raton. And Pancho Cristal, one of the biggest producers in New York, who's the producer of this album, by the way, heard it and came running out and said, "You know, you sound just like Cheo." And I said, "Oh, how wonderful." And he said, "You know, why don't you come to New York to record?" And I said, "No, I can't. I'm studying." Okay, now we jump into, he said, "If you ever get to New York, call me, kid. I'll make you a star." You know, blah, blah, blah. All the usual Broadway, you know. Yeah, come over here, kid. So about 10 months later, 8 months later, there's a military coup in Panama. The military take over government, and one of the first things they do is shut down the university. You know? So now, in 69, the university is closed. My mother is very concerned that I am going to do something foolish. So she'd rather lose me to New York, to music, than to have myself get into trouble. And I had a brother, Luis, who worked in Pan Am. So anyone who had a relative that was involved with the airline got to go to fly very cheaply. So I came to New York for like $20. I came to New York with $20 and a letter from Miguelito Valdez, the great Cuban singer, so that I would go and talk to a Pakistani gentleman who was running the Hotel Edison on West 46th Street and give him my room. I thought, wow, wonderful. You know, I was paying $20. And don't forget that. My mother gave me some money. $20 for us was a fortune. It was a $20 a day room. So I came here with that ticket. My mother said, "Go." I came, and then I called Pancho Cristal, who was nowhere in sight. I couldn't find him, and I thought I was going to, I don't know, didn't know what was going to happen to me. And then he appeared, and then we did this album with Pete Rodriguez, who was at the time the king of the Boogaloo. And we did the album like in 2 weeks. So the third week, we finished the album, and the last week I went back to Panama, waited for the university to reopen, and continued my studies, and never sang again until I graduated. That was the story of this record.
Yeah. Now.
Oh.
The first song, very first song in this album, we're going to hear a little bit of that song.
La historia que van a escuchar está basada en hechos ficticios. Cualquier semejanza con personas vivas o muertas es pura coincidencia. La patrulla ha llegado al pueblo con la noticia que acabaron con Juan González, el guerrillero, que por fin el león de la sierra reposa muerto. La guerrilla murió con él, grita un sargento. En la cañada del muerto fue la emboscada. Cogieron a la guerrilla hambrienta y cansada. Ay, en un bollo monte adentro se escucha el llanto de una mujer con un niño que está en pañales. Con ella lloran también los pobres del mundo. Los campos lloran la muerte de Juan González.
La sierra viste de luto, mataron a Juan González.
So, the very first song in your first album talks about a guerrillero, a guerrilla man. What inspired you to write songs about social issues when everybody else was talking about guaracha, bembé, y bailar y tal?
You know, I come from, I was very lucky. I was born in Panama. Very lucky to have been born in Panama. Panama is a very special place. And we heard so many different music from so many different places that we all grew up with a very wide range of interests and influences. And one thing that I noticed about salsa music at the time was that the themes were recurring themes. They were always the same themes. The guy who was betrayed by the friend, the guy who was betrayed by the woman, the guy that was again betrayed by another friend, the guy who was betrayed by the friend that went to the woman that took the friend. You know, so it was almost always the same thing. That was one line. The other line was everything that had to do with Africa, with something to do with Africa, not really understanding deeply the scenarios in Africa, but rather things that had to do with African religion. And then the third thing was everybody was following the Cuban patterns, the songs that had been recorded in Cuba for decades. So I was more interested in writing about what was around me. The only difference was that instead of writing only about the corner, I began to write about the city. And I think that it had to do also with the fact that I was, my grandmother, Emma, taught me how to read when I was about 4 or 5. So I was reading everything that I could. So I was very, very, very curious and a voracious reader. So that my love for literature and my curiosity, and what Gabriel said always, that I was a chronicle man, that I was a newspaper person, he said. I began to write about what was around me. And at the time, Che Guevara had been killed in 67. But I never liked to write, for instance, about a person himself, because nobody's perfect. There were things that are admirable about some people, and at the same time, there are things that are reprehensible about, or things that you simply don't agree with. But the idea of the guerrillero who faces injustice, for me always was Emiliano Zapata from Mexico. Emiliano Zapata, who not only fought, won, but went back. he went back to his land. And so that model was the thing at the time that inspired me. You also have to understand, from a business point of view, this was a horrible decision. Because in 1969, I think there was not going to get airplay. They simply are not going to play. The first thing you heard, in my naivete, I said, I'm going to explain myself so that in case they come to arrest me, I can argue. Say, but what are you talking about? Didn't you hear the record? It starts, la historia que van a escuchar, the story you're going to listen, está basada en hecho ficticio. It's based on fiction. Cualquier semejanza con personas o muertas, any similarity with dead or people who are alive, is pura coincidencia. It's just a coincidence. So that's how I started the song, because I said, they're going to come for me at some point, somebody. It's, you know, like the body snatchers, you know, and they're going to come and grab me. So I'll tell them, no, but it's fiction. But 8 of the 9 songs of that first album I wrote, and some of them are really, really terrible, terrible songs. But, you know, that's the way it is. And a song of my friend, the Dr. Roberto Cedeño, who gave the title to the record. And if you see from the beginning, always, Panama is in whatever and everything I do. So I call it De Panama a Nueva York. That's the story of the album. The album had one song, I think, was played, Descarga Caliente. I think it was very popular in Colombia, especially in places like Cali, in Medellin, you know, in Barranquilla, Cartagena. They're really, Buenaventura, they really love music. So.
But with that song, you started a kind of a genre, a type of songs that were not the common ones.
Right.
And there is a song that really marked me personally, but I think it reflects the poverty in Latin America. And it's a song we're going to listen to a little bit.
Regresa un hombre en silencio, de su trabajo cansado. Su paso no lleva prisa, su sombra nunca lo alcanza. Lo espera el barrio de siempre, con el farol en la esquina, con la basura ya enfrente y el ruido de la cantina. Pablo Pueblo llega hasta el zaguán oscuro y vuelve a ver las paredes con las viejas papeletas que prometían futuros en lides politiqueras, y en su cara se dibuja la decepción de la espera.
Pablo Pueblo. ¿Quién es Pablo Pueblo?
No, Pablo Pueblo eran todos mis vecinos. La gente que trabaja, la gente que... En mi casa yo lo vi siempre, y a mi familia trabajó toda su vida. Como digo yo, en casa del pobre hasta el feto trabaja. Las madres están trabajando con el pelado adentro o la pelada adentro. En casa del pobre hasta el feto trabaja. Y son gente correcta, la enorme mayoría de la gente es correcta, trabaja. Trata de hacer las cosas bien. Trata de brindarle un buen ejemplo a sus hijos, a sus hijas, a sus vecinos. O sea, por lo menos esos fueron los barrios que yo conocí. Y Pablo Pueblo es esa figura, esa persona que trabaja, hace las cosas bien y siempre tiene el problema, nunca sobran un centavo, siempre hay un problema y no recibe apoyo ni oportunidades, mientras que otra gente se la pasan robando y aprovechándose de todas las oportunidades que el Estado brinda y negándole la oportunidad a gente como esta. Entonces yo escribo sobre eso.
And tell us a little bit about this album, Metiendo Mano. Tell us about the album, Metiendo Mano.
Metiendo Mano is a Puerto Rican vocablo. It means getting it done. Mete mano, do it. Vamos. And I had never heard it before. I heard it here in New York. And I loved it. Mete mano. Vamos a meter mano. You know, it's like, wow. Vamos a hacerlo, let's do it, you know. So I thought, oh, that's great. Entonces vamos a poner metiendo mano. And then, because it was such a such a New Yorkian, Puerto Rican thing, we said, okay, so people get the, in Latin America, they get what we're trying to say, metiendo mano, let's dress me as a boxer. Metiendo mano, you know, so, oh, okay, that's what it is. And then Durán saw the gloves, and he said that those gloves did not represent my weight. You know, because Roberto Durán, you know, he knows everything in boxing. So he said, Concho, ¿por qué estás con esos guantes? Esos guantes no son del peso tuyo. What do I know? How would I know? I'm like a little boy. Put these things on and take your shirt off and stand over there. You know, so. And that's Willie Colon. Willie Colon, who was instrumental in getting these songs done. Because, yes, at the time... And I think at the time, Willie, different from other band leaders and musicians at the time, Willie did have a Pan-American concept, idea of what was going on. Because he was born and raised here, as many others, he didn't grasp the complexities of Latin American society. But he understood the issues. And the issues were the same whether you were in the South Bronx or in Panama or in Colombia or whatever. So when I came in with the lyrics, he consented and said, let's do this, these songs, which at the time were very, very different from anything else. Not only theme-wise, but length-wise. The songs were over 5 minutes long. That was... very long, and radio stations didn't want to play any song that lasted more than 2.5 minutes. So that was a problem. Then you had the content. A lot of the words were not familiar to non-Latino audiences. And then you had the political aspects of it, which were implied. They were not ideological, because I never would write an ideological song. That's propaganda. You know, and I'm not interested in that. I don't believe in ideologies, reign of control over your mind and spirit. That's why I could have never been a communist or a right winger, you know, because they don't think, they're in extremes. And I'm not interested in that. So he did agree to writing about, recording these songs, and I will forever be grateful for the opportunity to be able to record these songs and have the attention that was placed because of Willie Colon.
One of your most popular songs, which we're going to hear in a minute, was inspired Gabriel García Márquez to say he wished he had written that song.
You know, I thought that was an exaggeration. No, because people say that. Tú sabes que Gabriel García Márquez, él dijo, you know, come on. And then I found out it was true because after he died, I never asked him while he was alive, you know, hey, did you say that? I didn't even think of it, but then later on, I read it. It was an article that he wrote, and he wrote, Nada me hubiera gustado más que haber escrito la terrible historia de Pedro Navaja.
Let's listen to it.
Luis Perico Ortiz did the chart.
Por la esquina del viejo barrio lo vi pasar, con el tumbao que tienen los guapos al caminar, las manos siempre en los bolsillos de su gabán, pa' que no sepan en cuál de ellas lleva el puñal. Usa un sombrero de ala ancha de medio lado y zapatillas por si hay problemas salir volado. Lentes oscuros pa' que no sepan que está mirando, y un diente de oro que cuando ríe se ve brillando. Como a tres cuadras de aquella esquina una mujer va recorriendo la acera entera por quinta vez, y en un zaguán entra y se da un trago para olvidar que el día está flojo y no hay clientes para trabajar. Un carro pasa muy despacito por la avenida, no tiene marcas pero todos saben que es policía. Pedro Navaja, las manos siempre dentro al gabán, mira y sonríe y el diente de oro vuelve a brillar. Mientras camina, pasa la vista de esquina a esquina.
Muchas gracias. Thank you.
Well, that's proof that it's really one of your most popular songs.
You know, it's so interesting. When I was a kid, I spent so much time with my grandmother that I was probably the oldest kid who ever lived. I understood age so well, you know, and I think that's one of the reasons why I'm not afraid of death today or getting older. I'm not, because I was always old, and I understood. When I look back now, this song was the most horrible song ever written. As that was the assessment of the best DJs of New York at the time. They said the song was too long, and it is. It's about 7 minutes long. The song's themes are horrible, sordid. Who's gonna listen to this kind of crap? You know, and it was like the kiss of, one of them actually said that this could mean the commercial death. I'll never forget that. The commercial death of Willie Colon. You know, and then this was in 1977. That's 40 years ago. And I saw somebody some years ago, one of them, the gentleman. And I said, hi, how are you? He said, hello, how are you? I said, hey, how are you? I was happy to see him. And he said, do you remember what I told you about Pedro Navaja? And I said, yeah. He said, didn't I tell you it was going to be a smash? And I said, yes, I do. I do remember. Because what's the point, you know? What am I going to do now? But this song, there's so many important things. Luis Perico Ortiz did the chart for this song from Puerto Rico. One of the most decent people I've ever met in my life, and I'm somebody I'm so proud to call my friend. Perico is really wonderful, wonderful man. And one thing that Perico did that I asked him was, Luis, when we get to the mambo, break the clave. Break the clave. And he said, well, I said, break the clave because what the whole story is about a sudden occurrence. It's something that no one is expecting, and it happens. You know, a man who's looking for her. He was looking for her. He sees her, and he goes, because there's a story behind all this, and in time people will know, and will put one and one together, so that I want the clave to jump. And it's going to incommodate the dancer, because the dancer is dancing, and all of a sudden the clave jumps, and then you're off. It changes from one, two, three, two. It's 2-3. But I said, I want them to stop and get back to it. What happened? What happened is there was a stabbing. There was a shooting. That's what happened. If you're dancing and something happens, wouldn't you stop and look? I want them to react to that. This is not normal. Mm. So he did it. And then he had a lot of people jump on him because he broke clave. As if Luis Pericorti didn't know how to do an arrangement in clave. He's only done like 2,000 other arrangements in clave. But in this one, I asked him, break the clave, because we want to shake people into realizing something has happened. The other thing is, Pedro Navaja is probably the only salsa song, and I hope I'm wrong, but I think it's the only salsa song where a woman is attacked and the woman defends herself. Usually, all the songs, the woman was attacked and that was it. She got slapped, she got beaten, she got killed, and that was it. This time, she gets stabbed, she turns and she shoots the attacker and then has the last word, because she has the last word on the whole song. She's the one that says, hey, I thought I had a bad day, but look at you, idiot. You know. So, and that's one point that a lot of times people never didn't get in Pedro Navaja. And then the last thing is it changed the way radio stations made their formats. Because, I mean, can you imagine that in some radio stations, they started editing the song? Yeah. They go like first verse, and then they go to the third verse, and then they go to the last verse. So the song was like, made no sense. It jumped from one thing. It's like if you have a book and you're reading, and then all of a sudden there's like 10 pages are off, and then you're looking, what happened here? So, but they, I don't know how, they thought people wouldn't mind. And people started calling like, you mama, you're destroying the song, you piece of crap. And so they had to play the whole song. And that, what that did is it changed the formats. You know, the reason for the 2.5 minute thing is you play 2.5 minutes and then you have 2 minutes of commercials and then you do another 2.5 minutes and then you have 2 minutes of commercials. When you play 7 minutes, then that means you're losing 3 minutes of commercial time. And so the songs, and at the time, everything had to play against the tyranny of the radio format. And this broke it. The last thing is, it's incredible to me that this song, which is a very long song, like my answers, very long song, and this song, people still remember it to sing the song to this day. I mean, everywhere I go, you have people that you look at them and you know that you have shoes that are older than they are. And they know the song, and they know all the song, and that's amazing. And again, it's a chronicle. It's depicting the story. Life is full of surprises, yes, and everybody can relate to that. The last word is from a guy who's drunk, bumps into the two corpses, takes the gun, takes the knife, takes the money, and then thanks God. As if God had something to do with this. And then later on, he's attacked and robbed too. You know? So the song, through the years, the whole notion of the unexpected continues to be in our lives. And I think that's why I was lucky enough to be able to renovate my audience. It's very, very unusual to have younger people go see a show, to see someone who is as old or older than their folks, except if your name is Tony Bennett.
For the audience that is not familiar with this song tells the story of a petty criminal and a prostitute mm-hmm. that meet up somewhere. Where? Mm-hmm.
Well, every song that I write, that's timing. Every song that I write, I tend to imagine in two places, in Panama and New York. In Panama, because the place where I was born, and I live today in that same neighborhood, San Felipe. Every single thing, every single character to me is represented between San Felipe and Chorrillo. So you have San Felipe, you have Santana, you have Plaza Amador, and then you have Chorrillo. And everything that I write is reminiscent of something that has to do with that area. That's where when I was a kid, I spent a lot of time in San Felipe, Chorrillo. My father was from Santana. And then later on, when I was in school, my school was very near the Plaza Amador. It wasn't so far, some blocks away. So I played basketball in the intercollegiate leagues in the Chorrillo. When I was working with people in jail, I worked in a Cárcel Modelo, which is located in El Chorrillo. So, you know, a lot of the characters and the people and the visuals are from that area.
You told me something about that, actually, which was Los Dientes de Oro y Los Zapatillas. ¿Quiénes son esos?
En Panamá habían dos pandillas cuando yo crecía. Tenía 7 años, 8 años. Habían dos pandillas que salían todo el tiempo en los periódicos.
Two gangs.
Una era la pandilla de Los Dientes de Oro, Gold Tooth Gang, y la otra la pandilla de Las Zapatillas Negras, Black Sneakers. So if you had a gold tooth, y tenía zapatilla negra. ¿Cómo ve? Ven para acá. Entonces, eso a mí nunca se me olvidó, por eso el diente de oro de Pedro y la zapatilla. El gabán es de Nueva York. Porque en Latin America, I worked in government 5 years, and I asked the president, why do we need to wear a tie and wear these things that are going to kill us? I mean, it's so hot in here, you know? Entonces tienen una cosa en Panamá, que en los sacos, lana tropicalizada. You know what that means? Tropicalized wool. You see, we have some tropical sheep. You know, so I used to say, man, do we really need to wear suits in here? And we do. So, you know, so the jacket is not from my vision in Panama. It's from New York. When I, 42nd Street, the pimps, the guys, you know, they all had the big hats with the wide brims. That's also Pedro. And the jackets. So I integrated both images into Pedro. What I did not do, and I refused to do in many of my songs, is to do videos. If I had done a video of Pedro Navaja, then I ruined it, because Pedro Navaja, I don't say if he's black, if he's white, if he's oriental, if he's brown, Hindu. I don't say if he's tall, short, fat, thin. I don't say, you imagine it like when you read a book. You construct him in your mind. So if I do a video, then I lock it into that. And I refuse to do that. But the dress, you know, the shoes, the sneakers, the gold tooth, the big hat and the jacket, period. And the glasses.
So really your songs are kind of condensed books. What Garcia Marquez managed to do in 300 pages, you put in 6 minutes.
You know, that's exactly what Carlos Fuentes, a wonderful Mexican writer, told me once. Carlos and I were at Harvard at the same time. He was teaching and I was in school. And we used to get together to drink coffee and fix the world. And one day we're talking about, you know, the big discussion now that Dylan won the award in literature. Is he deserving of the literature award, Nobel? And Carlos told me very clearly, he said, you know, and he even went further. He said, I write a book, it's about 260 pages, and I have time to present the argument, Aristotelian argument, beginning, center, in resolution. You have 6 minutes to do this. And then people read my book and they probably will never read it again. Your song, they hear it once and again and again and again. And people who don't hear what you're writing, and they don't understand, they're listening to a short story. So he did say that. And Gabriel, the same thing. Gabriel, I had much longer discussions on this.
Actually, there is a bit of a funny story of how you met Gabriel Garcia Marquez.
No, first of all, I met Gabriel years before he was Nobel Prize winner. You know, people tend to remember Gabriel Garcia Marquez for 100 Years of Solitude. 100 Years of Solitude is from 1967. You know, Gabriel got the award in 82. So I met him much before that. And I read him much before that. And I read his articles. I mean, he was foremost a journalist, a newspaper man. That's what he was. Diario de un Náufrago is one of the best things I've ever read, and probably one of the most influential reports done ever in Latin America and maybe the world. So there was a guy who was a salsa fan who was also a fan of Gabriel Garcia Marquez in those days before the Nobel. So he told me, Gabriel, listen to my music. And I said, oh, that's nice because I read his books. And then he said, oh, I know him, so I can introduce you to him. I didn't pay much attention to him because he's one of those guys that I'm not sure. You know, he says he knows the Pope. Well, how nice is that? Good for you, you know. But I'm not sure. People talk and I don't know. So one day he calls me and he says, I told him I'm going to call him today at this hour. He was in the record studio, La Tierra, Fania. So come over at this hour and we'll call him in. I said, you'll call him. So I went because I was curious. And he called and a man on the other side says, hello. And I say, hello. And then he says, qué gusto. And I say, yo también. And I'm thinking, I don't know who this guy is. And he's thinking, I don't know who this guy is. So it was the shortest, weirdest conversation when I met Gabriel Garcia Marquez on the phone. Because we both thought the guy was fooling around. He got some friend saying, like, yeah, I'm Rubén, you know. And you got this guy, some guy saying, yeah, I'm Gabriel, you know. So it was very, you know, I really like your work. Yeah, I love your work too, you know. So hopefully we'll see each other. Yes, I do hope so. You know, okay. Boom. That was the meeting. Years later, I said, was that you, really? And it was. I said, well, that was me. But it was so weird. Porque Gabriel mamaba mucho gallo. Gabriel liked to kid, boy. He was a kidder.
But with that relationship, something happened, I mean, to you. You started thinking about recording an album with him or writing an album. Tell us a little bit about
it. I said he loved music. Gabriel really loved music, vallenato. And he loved the lyric and the dynamic of the vallenato. And I said, you know, one day, why don't we write a, why don't we do an album together? Why don't we write an album together? And he said, no. Real quick, no, no, no. And I said, why not? He said, because we never finish. And I said, what do you mean we'll never finish? He said, no, we're not going to finish. How are we going to finish? You're over there, I'm over here. And then I write something, I send it to you. You said, no, but why don't we do this? And then you send it back to me. And then I go, nah, why don't we do this? You do it. And then I said, well, I'm going to write about your early short stories. And he gave me all the permission, so I could use the titles. And I would periodically send him things so he would read them. And then I did the record. It was titled Agua de Luna. And it was the worst received album that I've ever done in my life, with the exception of the first one. And maybe even the first one maybe was better received. They said that it was a pretentious record. The salseros hated it because it wasn't salsa enough. And the intellectuals accused me of destroying García Márquez's work. So I called him one day. I said, Gabriel, ¿cómo estás? Y me dice, muy cansado. Digo, ¿qué pasa? Digo, es que me duelen los brazos de estarte defendiendo. Dice, te atacan tanto, tengo que estar yo cada rato corrigiendo. And it was very funny because I even told one person that, look, the Village Voice ran a review of the album, and I knew it wasn't going to be good. The album was called Agua de Luna, translation, moon water. The review from the Village Voice was water in the brain. So I wrote, I said, why don't you call it just hidrocephalia? That would have been kind of more interesting. They did not like the album. Nobody did. And I called Gabriel and he said, I did like it. And I said, well, okay, that makes two of us. There's one song that I had rescued, guys, Ojo de Perro Azul. And we played a lot that song, and people seem to like that one. And now I'm rescuing another one called Claroscuro, which is a combination of El Ahogado Más Hermoso del Mundo y El Mar de los Tiempos Perdidos. It's a combination of both short stories.
There is a song that you wrote inspired by Gabriel García Márquez.
By a conversation we had.
A short story. And we want to listen to it a little bit. And then you can tell us a bit about it.
This is a short story.
Despiertas, no has podido dormir muy bien. Te levantas, caminas y pisas uno de los charcos de orine que el nuevo perro ha dejado por toda la casa. Maldiciendo, entras al baño brincando en una sola pierna. Enciendes la luz y restriegas el pie sobre la cubierta que tu esposa le puso al excusado. Vas hasta la bañadera blanca, abres los dos grifos del agua y controlas la temperatura. Levantas la cosa esa que no sabes cómo se llama y que hace que el agua salga por la regadera. Te bañas, no cantas. Sales de la tina, te secas con una toalla que dice Disneylandia. Te subes a una balanza que da pesos, siempre diferentes pero aproximados. Cuando te estás afeitando suena el despertador. Tu mujer abre los ojos, mira la hora, lo apaga. Se levanta de su lado de la cama. Cada uno tiene su lado de la cama. Cada uno tiene su lado en todo. Tú la sientes saliendo del cuarto rumbo a la cocina. El vecino de arriba prendió el tocadisco. Terminas de afeitarte y te limpias las cortaditas con papel higiénico que se te queda pegado a la piel. Te pones el desodorante, 24 horas de protección constante. Un poco de colonia para después de afeitarse. Te arde la cara, sales del baño. Pisas otra vez el orine del perro. Le mientas la madre en voz alta. Tu esposa desde la cocina te pregunta qué te pasa. Tú le explicas gritando por qué no quieres otro perro en la casa. Mientras te secas el pie con la toalla mojada que dice Disneylandia, ella se aparece y silenciosamente seca con un trapo el charco de orine. Vas al closet y sacas la ropa que te vas a poner. Miras el reloj, hueles el café, te vistes. No encuentras la correa. Te haces la corbata dos veces, porque la primera vez la parte de atrás te quedó más larga que la parte de adelante. Vas a la cocina. Tu esposa ya preparó tu desayuno. Le hablas otra vez del perro. Ella, sin contestarte, te recuerda que hay que pagar la cuenta de la luz y la matrícula de la escuela de los chiquillos. Cuelgas tu jacket del borde de la silla y te sientas en la mesa de la cocina. Tu esposa enciende el radio. Están transmitiendo las noticias. Mientras escuchas, mojas el pan en el café como te enseñó tu papá cuando eras niño. Suena el teléfono, tu esposa lo contesta. Es para ti, de la oficina. Hoy van a arrestar al tipo. Va un carro a recogerte, que lo esperes abajo. Cuelgas el teléfono, vas a tu cuarto. Abres la segunda gaveta del armario, tu gaveta. Sacas tu libreta y tus lentes negros. Vas a la cama.
El título de esa canción, the title of that song is GDBD. GDBD. And everybody's curious to know, what is that?
GDBD means gente despertando bajo dictadura. GDBD. And that was the first half, la primera mitad de un cuento corto. La segunda mitad es GDBD 2. Gente despertando bajo democracia. Y lo que decía Arendt about the banality of evil. You know, when you listen to, first of all, ¿tú tienes la copia aquí?
Ah,
mira. You know, this thing was born out of conversation with García Márquez. We were talking about literature, music, the contribution of popular music to literature. Now, a huge discussion against because of the Dylan situation. And I told Gabriel, I said, "Tú sabes, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to write a short story and I'm going to sing it." And he looked at me and he had kid's eyes, you know, mischievous kid's eyes. He would, like, when something was like ping, you could, his eyes went to back and he became like 5 years old. So he looked at me and he said, "How are you going to, ¿cómo vas a hacer eso? How are you going to do that?" And he goes, "I'm going to write the short story and I'm going to sing it." And he said, "But how are you going to do that? Are you going to write an arrangement?" I said, "No, I'm not going to write any arrangement or anything. I'm just going to sing it." But he says, "But how can you do that?" And he was reading something. And then I took it and I did that. Despierta, no ha podido dormir muy bien. I started to sing whatever he was that he had in his hands. And then he went, "Oh, okay." He said, "I'm going to do it. And nobody's going to know. And then I'm going to present it in a salsa album. And nobody's going to understand that they're listening to a short story." So I needed to have a background. If you go to 46, 47th Street, still there, there's a grill in 7th Avenue. If you pay attention, you're going to hear a noise coming down from the grill. The noise is something like this. I remember I heard it once coming out of recording about 3 o'clock in the morning. It snowed very hard and I heard that noise and I didn't know what it was, and the next day I went and I heard it, and it took me a long time to understand what it was. It's a sonorous sculpture. Some Danish artist created this sculpture of sound. And the idea was for the sound to blend with the sounds of New York, which is probably why people don't realize it's there. So I took that, and that was the foundation for my tone so I could sing. Despiertas, from there. And I recorded it. And I think last year or 2 years ago, they had a conversatorio in Medellin about García Márquez. And I went and I explained the story. And that's what you just heard. And with that, there should be the end of the discussion of whether or not literature can become popular music. Yes.
Not only that, but that song appeared in one album that is probably one of your, at the time, of course, the most innovative albums in Latin music, which was Buscando America. And it's a very interesting, you know, carátula del disco, the front, the sleeve.
It's kind of like religious or sacrilegious, depending on it. We were not totally naked. You know, no, none of the musicians would take their pants off. So, but it is an interesting.
Yeah. Rubén, there are a number of, I'm just going to read them because it's better. Juan González, Juan Pachanga, Pedro Navaja, Pablo Pueblo, Ligia Elena, Quique Quiñones, Manuela, Rafael da Silva. Where do all these characters come from?
They're all people that I have met through my life. Some of them are, most of them are composites. My grandmother, my mother are in Manuela Pérez. Ligia Elena, girls that I met in Panama, and I knew in Panama. Quique, Quiñones, Foncho Linares from Panama. And all of these are friends, people that I have met, people that have been in my life, or people that I have witnessed existed. And they have all become part of, not just of my work as a musician, but of my life. I mean, I'm preparing something on that issue, on the characters. You know, because I wonder where, you know, again, the whole story, the Pirandello story, you know, where characters go when the story is done, what happens, you know, with them. But they continue to live, and they will continue to live because they are a part of Latin America, each one of them. I mean, and they have different names, but they are existing people.
It seems like a lot of your songs are theatrical in a way.
I try to make it so, again, that has to do with books. You know, if you read different people, Honoré de Balzac, for instance, was very, you know, clear about. I mean, if you read Honoré de Balzac, you can imagine exactly how France was in the description of everything. He would describe the room completely, but I mean minutiously. The whole thing of La Comédie Humaine also, like all those books that somehow connected with each other for a period of 20 years. You know, this is basically what I've been doing with the albums. If I'm beginning now to understand what I was doing, in that I'm beginning to understand what the connections are between different songs and the characters themselves. For instance, you can look and look and look, and you can find, if you really look carefully, who ended up with Ligia Elena. If you look carefully, you will find it. And some of these are revelations that you end up going, oh, I didn't understand this part. So you were asking about the connection between the characters. They are all part of this one big story called Maestra Vida, basically. It's just the whole thing is Maestra Vida, which was a musical that I wrote in 1980. And every single thing that I've ever written, I think, was geared to Maestra Vida.
Y Maestra Vida tiene una introducción muy interesante que la hizo un compatriota, César Miguel Rondón. Venezuela. La última frase que él dice es, la música es solo un pretexto. Mm-hmm. Music is just an excuse. Mm-hmm. What is that?
Él básicamente lo que te decía que, es decir, nosotros vivimos esas historias, nosotros creamos esas historias, y la música lo que nos brinda es la oportunidad de recordarlas, revivirlas, y también la posibilidad de establecer la solidaridad esa que existe. Aquí ahora mismo hay personas que vienen de distintos países de Latinoamérica. Nosotros tenemos la oportunidad, por ejemplo, de reunirnos cuando hablamos de música o cuando hablamos de deporte. Entonces podemos cerrar filas, pero en otras áreas nos resulta más difícil. Por eso la música en este sentido es un pretexto, porque lo que hace es que te ayuda, te crea el terreno para que tú te reconozcas a sí mismo en la cara de otro también. Y ese es el aspecto, uno de los aspectos más importantes, yo creo, de este tipo de contribución. Y no podemos tampoco dejar por fuera la contribución de Brasil, porque hay gente como Chico Buarque, ¿no? Caetano Veloso, Gilberto Gil, Jorge Bem, Marcos Valle, Carlos Lira, hay tanta gente que como compositores, Vinicio de Moraes, Jovín, es decir, son gente que, como Puerto Rico, Tite Cureta Alonso, ¿sabes? Son gente que han estado escribiendo y también yendo en esa dirección de formular argumentos que son argumentos que nos hacen ver que no estamos solos y que sirven para crear esa unión que a veces las políticas es utilizada para separar.
Hay un dato curioso sobre Maestra Vida, el disco, el segundo de Maestra Vida number two, which is a song called Yo Soy Una Mujer. And I want to close this topic of music with that song. Tell us about that song.
Mi mamá, Anolan, ella se llama Anolan Bellido de Luna, pero su nombre como músico, Anolan Díaz. Hay personas que entonces cometen el error de creer que el apellido de mi mamá era Díaz. El apellido de mi mamá no era Díaz, es Bellido de Luna. Es un apellido compuesto, español. Mi mamá, como Anolan Díaz, fue una excelente cantante. Tocaba piano muy bien también. Una excelente persona, mi mamá. Y una excelente cantante, mucho mejor que yo como artista. Y nunca tuvo la oportunidad de poder desarrollarse como su talento se lo hubiese permitido. Tuvo dos programas de televisión en Panamá, musicales, martes a las 8 y la hora continental. Y nunca grabó. Mi mamá nunca había grabado. Y cuando yo hice Maestra Vida, yo escribí esta pequeña canción, porque era una parte muy pequeña. Y ya cuando mi mamá estaba un poco más entrada en edad, y entonces le di la oportunidad a ella para que cantara, porque la idea era que por lo menos una vez en su vida grabara algo. Y entonces la voz de mi mamá es la que aparece grabada en la canción. Ella es la que canta Yo Soy Una Mujer. Y era porque era importante también que la presencia de Manuela estuviese también reflejando la posibilidad de desvirtuar los estereotipos esos, de que la mujer solamente está allí pues para recibir golpes o para solamente parir hijos o para satisfacer los antojos del macho. Y entonces mi mamá cantó ese tema.
So now you know, Rubén's mom's.
Yeah, she's the one who sang it.
All right. Thank now, you. Now, Rubén.
Muchas gracias, thank you.
If we continue talking about your songs, we're going to be here until 2019. We can't.
Yeah.
There is an aspect of your story, which is your political career. Mm-hmm. You ran for president of Panama in 1994. You were minister of tourism in Panama, 2004,
2009.
So tell us about what happened after you finished. You know, you spent those years as a minister of tourism, and what was your experience?
First of all, anytime I mention, cuando hablo de esto, whenever I speak about this, some people think that I am complaining. I am not complaining at all. But I mention it only because it is important that it is mentioned. I, for 5 years, worked in government in Panama. And that's all I did. I didn't write songs. I didn't sing songs. I did not do albums. I did not go on tours. I didn't do movies. I worked for 5 years in my country for my people, and I tried to do the best I could, okay? And I think we, all of us, not just me, all of us did something good while we were there. When I cannot send somebody to sing for me. You know? Oh, there's a concert. No, Rubén is a minister. Yeah, pero anda tú por mí. Go for it. You know, you sing for me. No. You go or you don't go. Oh, there's a movie. Yeah, Rubén, no. Let's send Carlos. Carlos, you go for me. So when you're dedicated to that, that's what you're going to do. I came into the service, the public service, and I left less selfish, better person, more believing in my country and my people, and in the possibility of government. I came out of there a better person than when I walked in. But when I got out, I had to go to work. I didn't go out there because I took millions from Odebrecht or because I took millions from whatever. You know, I work. That's what I do. That's what my family does. And that's what 99% of Panamanians do, work. And work in something that is correct and legal. So when I went out, I went back to the music. And thank God people still wanted to listen to me, because one thing I've learned, not only when you get older, it's more difficult to find work, but nobody's holding your position. Nobody's, nadie te está guardando el puesto. Diga, te fuiste, okay, vamos a esperar que él venga. No. No, 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 no. It's like you go to this place to buy bread, the bakery is closed, okay. You come the next day, bakery closed. Next week, close. You don't never go back to that bakery. You go buy your bread somewhere else now. You know? So, some people, they quit business. They have their own businesses while they are working in government. And some of us don't. But the reason that I mention this is because if you really love your country and if you really want to be consistent with what you say, then preach it and do it. I closed my business for 5 years to serve my country. It's one of the best things I have ever done, and I thank God that I ever did that, and I'm very happy. Please. So, yeah. So, thank you. But when I came out a better person, because servicio público es un apostolado. Eso es lo que es. ¿No? Y yo lo digo y lo repito porque espero que gente joven que no tiene fe en el gobierno, que no tiene fe en las instituciones públicas, le digo, sí tenemos que tener fe que nosotros podemos mejorar esta situación. Y que esa gente que desvirtúa el servicio público, nosotros podemos reemplazarla con gente correcta. Y eso es lo que tenemos que hacer. Punto. But nobody can tell me that we can't do this. Every so often you find with things like Donald Trump. You know, and again, with all due respect, I shouldn't even have said that, but we need to help make things better. All of us. That's what we need to do. As opposed to just harping and, you know, we need to try to make things better for all of us, not just for one little group of people, for all of us. That's what I think, that was my effort.
Fear of walking dead. Se me ocurre que we didn't talk really about your extensive career in the film and TV industry. How did you get to do films? How did you get to do your first film?
Look, you know, I was in Fania, and then Jerry Masucci, who at the time was the, God rest his soul, he was the Fania president, and he decided that he was going to be a film producer. And then he wrote a script, or somebody did. It was about this thick. And then there was a role of a guy who was a boxer, who also sang, because we need to get an album out of this. And it was offered to me. I thought it was ridiculous, but I thought this is a really interesting opportunity because I grew up watching movies. I'm gonna be in a film. Wow, sure. So I did it. Willie Colon was also hired, and Willie played the mafia guy who befriended, his boxer was his friend, and he was his manager, and blah, blah, blah. So we did the movie. I remember I saw the film, and when I saw myself that came out the first time, I thought, who is that fat person there that sounds like me? Awful. And I said, I'm never going to do this again. I'm never going to do movies again. You have, you know, I said, I'm never going to get do this again. And then a friend of mine came to me and started saying to me, hey, we're doing this movie, and we really want you to be in it. And I said, you know, I don't see myself. I don't see myself like talented, like to do movies. You know, I'm. No, I don't think so. And he said, come on, let's do this. And I did it. Leon Ichazo. We did a film called Crossover Dreams. And that film was well accepted. And then I got somebody who was a great agent here in New York. And he said, I'm going to represent you. And it was luck. You know how hard it is to get an agent? It's very difficult to get an agent. It's not easy. So, and I got a call from Redford. Robert Redford's gonna do a movie, second film, after Ordinary People, and called The Milagro Binfield War. And then Whoopi Goldberg was doing a movie and said, I like to work with her. And then Richard Pryor said, oh, I like to work with him. So, and I started sort of doing films, but it wasn't really like set into a movie career or anything. The best thing I ever did was something that I did at the time for HBO. They were beginning with original films, and I worked with Danny Glover. We did a movie called Dead Man Out. I played a death row inmate, and the whole film was about the morality of the death penalty. And I got an award as best actor for that role. And thank you. And then from then on, I started getting calls, you know, but I also started developing this image of like, this guy is weird. Because they would call and say like, oh, we'd like to offer Ruben this this role. Oh, I'm sorry, but Ruben right now is not available. Oh, no, what is he doing? He's in Panama, sir. Oh, he's doing a film? No. What is he doing? He's running for president. Excuse me? Michael Keaton, I was walking the dog in Santa Monica. I was walking the dog, and Michael Keaton came to me and said, is it true? And I knew exactly what he was saying. And I said, yes. And he looked at me, and he said, why? So I think, again, the thing about the bread and the bakery, I said, you know what, that guy is kind of weird. And then when I left for the 5 years, and you know, they call you, and then they go like, well, what is he doing now? He's minister of state. Why? So I'm lucky. I worked with Jack Nicholson and Two Jakes. I worked with Harrison Ford and Devil's Own, Diane Keaton and the Lemon Sisters, Christopher Walken and Milagro Binfield War. I mean, Anthony Hopkins in One Man's War. You know, I mean, I worked with really, really good, Christine Latty and Crazy from the Heart. I worked with a lot of great people. And it was funny. I mean, at the end of the day, you go like, what's your secret? I said, I have no secret. I have no idea how this happened. And it's a great, I've had a lot of fun too. I mean, you know, so I cannot explain how it happened, because if I ever try to tell somebody to do what I did, it would fail. It would definitely fail. Don't ever do that at home, kids. Don't try that, because it's not going to work. Hmm.
So now we fast forward 2017. What is up for Ruben in the future? And what's the future of Latin music?
I think Latin music is going to continue to grow. I think it's going to become stronger. I've never been scared that somehow genres are going to disappear. Like, salsa is not going to disappear. Ever. Never. No. Brazilian music is going to continue. La Gaita is going to continue in Venezuela. You know, I mean, Cuban music is going to continue to be strong. La música de Puerto Rico is going to continue to be strong. La música de México is going to continue to be strong. So I really think that what we're going to witness is evolutions, fusions. And my wife was here right now, Luba Mason. She's a great singer, actress on her own. She's dealing with a concept called mixtura, which is to have different types of music integrated into a show and an album. So I suspect that the music is going to continue to grow and continue to enrich art worldwide. Hmm. Right now there's bands that come from, I mean, I got people sending me music from Israel. In Israel, there's a band playing Papo Luca songs. You know? Yeah. And then I have a Hindu version of Besame Mucho. You know? It's like you get all these kind of things that you go like, wow, why didn't I think of that? So the Punjab music, Punjab from India. If you listen to the Punjab, you're gonna some versions of Punjab music. You're gonna hear a clave there, and you're also gonna hear some songs, some Punjab rhythms that are just like merengue, Dominican merengue. Juan Luis Guerra is gonna continue to write the wonderful things that he writes, and more Dominicans are gonna continue to be influenced by what Romeo and all those guys are doing now. So, I see music going forward.
What about Ruben? What about you? What are your plans?
The thing is, you know, after when there's a moment in your life when you realize that you have more past than future. And then, if you're smart, then you sit down and you try to think, what can I do if, yo primero, I'm healthy? That's the thing. You pray, or you hope that you're healthy. And then you think, okay, I'm not going to be delantero in Barcelona. That's out. I'm not going to be a forward for the Knicks. And the Knicks need a miracle anyway. Or several miracles. There's some things I'm not going to be a torero. I'm not going to, you know, there's some things I'm not going to do. So, okay, so healthy and all, you figure, okay, next 11 years, what is feasible? What am I going to do? One thing I'm considering at this time is going back into politics. Considering it. Because first, I would like to be able to deal with all the present obligations that I have. You know, as you get older, and I said it, you get less work opportunities. And I know that people think that because you do movies, you know, you're making the millions of dollars that Tom Hanks is making. That doesn't work that way. And so once you take care of the things that you need to take care of, also to protect those that you have obligations towards, then the idea of serving, going back to public service, is something that appeals to me. in the interim, I mean, in lieu of that, continue to produce music. Right now I'm working in about 7 different albums of different genres, different types of music. I'm recording them right now as we speak. I have work in theater for the future, hopefully. My Travida is one of those things that I'm hopefully looking forward to presenting as a theater piece and as a film as well, working on a script. There is a work that I'm doing with Leonardo Padura from Cuba, Leonardo, and his wife Lucia, working on a script, a film script. And there's the work that you can do helping people that are coming up, you know, supporting people like Danilo Perez's Fundación, La Fundación de Danilo Perez in Panama, does a great, great job helping kids and initiating them in music as a career. And Danilo and Patricia are doing an excellent job. I help them, and I hope that I can continue to increase my contributions to them. They are doing an excellent job. And Danilo is one of the best piano players in the world, and a wonderful human being also. His mother and father, I know them, they know me since I was a kid, and they knew my mother and my father as well. So there's just a lot of stuff that I like to get myself involved, the production of documentaries. I want to continue painting. I began to paint years ago, and I don't know what I'm doing, but I have fun. And writing, that's important. I'm thinking, I'm writing. I would like to set certain things straight before I die, because if I don't, somebody else is gonna go and try to, and it's gonna be, instead of a horse, it's gonna come up a camel. So, you know, I have things to do. I mean, I never understood that thing about being old and like not being productive. That's such a stupid thing. Who says, you know, if I were in government, I mean, the one thing I would do immediately is try to bring back all the wisdom and all the experience that is out there that is not being used, you know, to teach kids and to teach people. It's a shame. You have to share what you know. That's the foundation of everything. What good is it for you to know something if you don't share it, right? So it's absurd. So I'm looking forward to, I just hope that I'm healthy, that's all.
Good. Rubén Blades' latest album is Son de Panamá. Mm. You should all head to rubenblades.com to find his records, his bootlegs, and look out for what's coming next. Thank you very much,
Rubén. Muchas gracias a ti, man. Muchas gracias a todos ustedes por venir hoy. Thank you so much for coming tonight. Appreciate it. Thank you very much. Muchas gracias. Muchas gracias.
Pero todos saben que policía. Pedro Navaja, las manos siempre dentro al gabán. Mira y sonríe y el diente de oro vuelve a brillar. Mientras camina, pasa la vista de esquina a esquina. No se ve un alma, está desierta toda la avenida. Cuando de pronto esa mujer sale del zaguán y Pedro Navaja aprieta un puño dentro del gabán. Mira pa' un lado, mira pa' el otro y no ve a nadie. Y a la carrera, pero sin ruido, cruza la calle. Y mientras tanto en la otra acera va esa mujer refunfuñando, pues no hizo pesos con qué comer. Mientras camina